Yes, thank you. And I would like in my paper to present a new museum, Tirpitz, which I have been working on as a part of a project team. As you all can see from my paper's heading, or just by looking at me, I'm an old archaeologist. I have worked for my museum at Varde for about 28 years, mostly making rescue excavation. Here you can see field work exactly 1 week ago when Stina and I digged some nice Iron Age graves. Stina and I have also worked together in the Tirpitz project, and she will speak after me. In my many years at Vardemuseerne Museum, I had also made a lot of exhibition, mostly in the old-fashioned way, by using what the museum got of old showcases and make some text, mostly too long. Very interesting, of course, if you like the subject as much as I do, but probably very boring for many others. The location for our new museum are in the most western part of Denmark, where an old bunker called Tirpitz since 1991 had been used as a small museum. This is the new museum, Tirpitz. In 2014, Vardemuseerne had collected most of the money and got the plans ready for the new Tirpitz Museum, and the hard work started. I think more hard than any of us could have imagined. I would first of all stress that Tirpitz had gone to be a great success. Before I come to all the troubles and difficulties, people really love it, and we have in the first year around 300,000 visitors. Stina will later explain about the target groups and how the exhibition was created to match different people. So to start with the beginning, Vardemuseerne got a new director in 2007, Klaus Kjeld Jensen. At that time, Vardemuseerne had 14 smaller or bigger museums. His overall strategy was to close some of the old museums and make a fewer, bigger, and more visitor-friendly museums. To the left and in the middle, you see the old Tirpitz Museum. To the right, our old Amber Museum in Oksbøl, and underneath Blåvand Museum. The decision was to close two of them and move the most interesting of the content to Tirpitz and build a brand new museum in connection to the old bunker. The world famous architect Bjarke Engels, head of Bjarke Engels Group, also known as BIG, was asked to draw our new museum in Blåvand. The task BIG was given was quite a challenge. Make the most spectacular, fantastic museum's building that nobody can see. The nature in the whole area are protected, and normally it would have been impossible to build here. Fortunately, was the dune behind the bunkers not real nature, but a ram made by the German in 44 when they constructed the bunker, so we could argue it was okay to build the museum here. But still, because of the nature, it had been to be a discreet building which not disturbed the nature. BIG made a great solution, which matched our need of four exhibition rooms. The whole building was mostly built underground, and only in the middle, not seen from the outside, are very big windows. The architect preferred room with daylight, where people felt comfortable. I would really have preferred darker room because of the preservation of the fragile museum's items, and the difficulties to show movies and pictures on the wall using projectors in daylight. But I must agree that it gives visitors a nice view into the museum, and I think a lot of tourists who normally just would have passed the museum's yard now come back later and pay the entrance fee and to have a closer look. From the beginning, we have an overall plan of the exhibition. Three rooms for permanent exhibition and one for temporary. The three permanent exhibition were an army of concrete about the Atlantic Wall, West Coast stories, different stories from the area from Ice Age until today, and Gold of the Sea, an exhibition about amber, which I was in charge of. We started to read about the different subjects and study our collection to find out what we would like to tell and what items we would like to exhibit. We also take us time to visit museums together and discuss what we like and dislike. The result was a raw draft or a storyline, and of course some suggestion for which object to show. It was obvious that we don't have the expertise in-house to build three exhibitions with all that modern technology and fancy decoration and nice showcases which are accustomed today. So we asked three different companies to make suggestions for how they would like to make three different permanent exhibitions from our draft. It was quite a competition, and all the companies were surprisingly creative, and there were plenty of ideas we would never have thought of by ourselves. It was Tinker Imagineers from Utrecht in Holland who won the competition, and when they started the work, they challenged us again and again. I would say they are wonderful people with so much fantasy, and it has been so much fun to work with them, but they sometimes prefer the good stories a little more than exactness. Vardemuseum have an extraordinary amber collection, and the goal of the exhibitions was not to show it all, but select items which could tell an interesting story or impress people by being very rare or beautiful. In an early stage, we have some argument about what to show. I would really have liked to show something about handicraft, manufacturing the amber through the times, and I would have liked to show some old tools, but the designers think that that was boring, and the old tools wasn't nice enough to put on display. So that story we have to leave out. Central in the exhibition was planned a treasure room where we should display man-made amber from Stone Age to modern times. The selection of the items to this was also a bit of a fight. My goal was to show how people use of amber changed through the times. By studying the amber, it is possible to see how fashion changed, but it also tell about fate and trading. Interesting are that we in the Danish Neolithic have a huge amount of amber in the finds, which more or less disappear in the Bronze Age. In the Iron Age, the amber come back in graves, often in combination with imported glass beads. To tell these stories, I think it's not enough to show the amber alone, and as an archaeologist, I couldn't stand to take the amber out of its context. At last, I succeeded to show the whole content in most of the finds, and I think the result are beautiful and explain how the amber was used together with other objects in different periods. After we have agreed on which story we want to tell and what object we would show, and Tinker had made a design everybody liked, and we were so ready to start, we got a new problem. Big, the architect, saw the design, and for some parts the architect couldn't approve. They don't want anything to touch their beautiful building, especially not the roof. And he don't like the fairy tale expression of the amber forest, and he doesn't think the choice of material matches the building. So less than 6 months before opening, Tinker had to make a whole new design for the amber exhibition. What before was made of wood was now perforated steel, which made the exhibition many times more expensive, but maybe also more stylish, I think. And the light effect came out to be very beautiful. The color changing all the times, not like you see here, it looked like a disco, but in the exhibition, you see the color change from dripping orange resin to blue water rising in the bottom, which are very effectful when you tell the story about the amber was created 40 million years ago. While building it was very complicated. Mounting the object ended up to be quite a nightmare. First, very late in the process, Tinker hired a man to do the job. He came to Denmark and made photos of all the amber pieces, and the plan was to come back 2 weeks before the opening and fasten the objects. I suggest that our conservators should have began the job months before, supervised by him, and I asked several times for the company to send some samples for the textiles that should be the background. I know the design for it was black, and I have again and again said that I would like to avoid velvet, but it ended up black velvet, which are the worst background material at all. It attract dust, and you can still see the fingerprints from the mountain. When they came to Denmark to make the mountain, it was clear after a few days work, it was impossible for two persons on the job to finish. Luckily, some of our local conservators jumped in the last moment. Another problem which made me sleepless was question of the security of the showcases for the treasure room. It seems to be an impossible job for the designers to make showcases which security standards are high enough for the demand from the National Museum, which also, in my opinion, are ridiculous. I think that the standard security showcases they could recommend it look like ugly telephone boxes. You can see on the picture here on the right. And I really have the understanding of that it's very difficult for designers to make beautiful showcases which are secure enough. I think we have some of a problem there. Now it ended up that we have to cancel all our loans from the Royal Collection and National Museum, but we have beautiful showcases. One of my personal biggest challenges was the decision that the exhibition should be without text at all. I love reading, and I think it is important to orient you in an exhibition by reading, to make a fast overview and then read the text of the subject who interests you most. But I had to admit that the solution with this kind of small, handy audio guide worked perfect. You hold the audio near the point of the showcase you would like to know something about, and you get a short story in your chosen language, Danish, English, or German. It was very difficult to make the story short enough, and every time I complain and want to add more facts, I was told to read a book about Amber, and that's what I'm doing now. In the treasure room, I was allowed also to make some text for the objects in hidden drawers about the age and the use, but I had to admit that it's only used by very few people. One of the best things with the audio guides is that children like them very much. They go silent around and listen, and you don't have parents and grandparents reading text for the children very loudly. To sum up, it has been a huge challenge to work with architects and designers who does not have the same view on what is interesting and how to handle museums' items. But I had to admit that they know much better than I to create a success. So I think Stina will go on now.